A really exciting new tool for multi-character consistency. Spoiler alert, the results were really, really impressive. The accuracy is incredible. If you are a narrative AI filmmaker, I've got several things to tell you about that'll be really exciting. I'll try and get to the point, but in order for me to spend more time working on my movie, which is what this whole channel is about, I'm trying to turn my screenplay into a watchable movie using emerging AI tools. In order for me to spend more time doing that, I have to spend less time making these videos, so it's going to be a bit shoveled, forgive me. I'm going to put chapters at the bottom, so if you're bored, skip to the next chapter. Here's what I'm going to be covering in this video. Three big things if you're a narrative AI filmmaker. Firstly, cinematic image quality using ImageFX from Google. Oh, I was blown away. I'll show you. The other one is Katalist going from strength to strength, and it's got a really exciting new tool for multi-character consistency. Spoiler alert, there are four main elements that I used for the test: a background, a dragon, a damsel in distress, and a rescuing guy with a sword. And the results were really, really impressive, particularly compared to a couple of other tools that I tried, this multi-reference image. The downside is they haven't quite nailed a cinematic look yet in terms of the realism, but in terms of the accuracy, it's incredible. So it's a really important step towards the right direction, and they're almost there with narrative filmmaking. You got to watch it. Have a look. You'll see what I mean. It's kind of a hand-drawn style, but it's looking brilliant. The other thing is consistent backgrounds or background continuity. I'm going to show you how I use design to switch a background round so that I got two shots and I could use a before and after shot, and they blended together much better. So let's get started. First thing I want to bring you up to speed on is this is my AI filmmaking wish list, okay? This list grows, but it doesn't really change much. These are all the things that we need to be able to control in order to tell a story using AI tools. It's more than just character consistency. Character consistency is one important element, but there are so many other things, as you'll see from this list, that you need to be able to control with cast iron guarantee levels of control, almost video game levels of control, if you need to tell a story. So I'm going to start adding on here the tools that have come up with a solution, a workable solution for this. So for example, gaze and expression, you know, where a character is looking and the expression on their face. I made a video about this. Dzine has done an incredible job at introducing a tool, and I'll show you later how I used it to control where a character is looking and the expression on their face. Really, really good. Anyway, so as I go through this list, as time goes on, when I find a tool that cracks one of these problems, I'll add it to the list until eventually, finally, we'll find a way of being able to genuinely create movies and TV shows or just narratives with this level of control. Now, today, I'm going to show you Katalist. And this is really exciting. So it's multiple consistent characters per shot. This is a big deal. It's one thing having one consistent character per shot. There are lots of tools around that are doing that now, but multiple consistent characters. In fact, it's more than just consistent characters. It's consistent elements. So like for this, as I mentioned, I've got a background that remains incredibly consistent. I've got a dragon that remains incredibly consistent. Two characters that remain incredibly consistent. It's really exciting. Now, this is the first test because I'm busy, 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 and I haven't finished all this, but you've got to see this first test. So let me just show you very quickly, by the way, before I move on to that, this is my current workflow. So I'm going to keep updating this because I don't want to be using lots and lots of tools. It gets confusing. I'm trying to drill down on a few tools that work well. And this is kind of the flow. Katalist is becoming absolutely becoming a workhorse tool for me for storyboarding, and they're building asset library features into that, which means it's a place as you're generating lots and lots of reference images for characters, for locations, for costumes, for vehicles, for everything that your project is going to need for a big project. At the moment, I'm using a Google Drive to gather them together so the whole team can look at them. But Katalist are planning on, they're working to build those features into the tool so it becomes kind of your central repository for the whole project. For every step along this journey, from script to finished demo movie, I suppose, at the end here, there are lots of problems to be solved. And when any of these AI companies are willing to listen to me, I'm really eager to say, This is what's needed in order for me to turn this into a watchable movie. And if you solve this problem, figure out how to do it for me, there'll be a lot of people behind me who with scripts and screenplays and stories that they would also love to do that with. So if you are with one of the big video companies and you're interested in having a chat, I'd love to talk. Zoom call. Anyway, let's move on quickly to ImageFX. Let me show you the results that I've had here. I used a prompt. This is what I had at the end of my prompt. It made it really consistent. But the 35mm film, highly detailed, realistic cinematic film still gave me... look at this. I mean, this looks like a still shot from a movie. Like, it actually legitimately looks like a still shot from a movie. It's what I prompted for, and it just looks like you could have... It's amazing. Well, I was consistently getting those kind of results from ImageFX, from Google. So it's free to use, by the way. Go nuts with it. Go have fun with it. The interface is hit and miss. It's basic, but the quality of the results is like... These are mouthwateringly impressive. And the accuracy of the understanding is really impressive, too. Here's what I've been doing with... Katalist. Okay, so this is the first scene that we're working on, and I've made it through the first six shots. Like these top ones here, I created these using ImageFX. Let me show you what they're looking like. So that was that one. Then this one looks like a still shot from a movie as well. Similarly, like a still shot from a movie. What I want to show you is this shot here. Okay. In fact, not this one, but two shots where I blended one to the other. So here's this girl here, and she's screaming at a dragon. This is the opening scene. It starts out with a little swooping street view of London, and then it goes down the streets, and then finally comes to a stop at a screaming girl, and you're like, what's she screaming at? And the camera flips around, and it's this this playful, half-realistic, half-animated dragon. That's deliberate. I wanted that style. Standing in the middle of Oxford Street in London. And then comes to the rescue this guy who turns out to be a homeless guy who was just watching this girl and daydreaming about doing something heroic for her. Anyway, he comes leaping over. So I needed this shot here and this shot here to blend into each other. The problem is the original images, look. Right, so here it is. Here's the original shot, and then I needed a shot late to cut back to where he jumps into the shot, and this is that shot. The problem is, look at the background. The background is very similar, but it's different in all kinds of subtle ways. So you've got the lights at the top up here are different. You've got the bus that's slightly different. You've got a taxi that's in a slightly different place. But mostly, everything is subtly but significantly different. The reason that's a problem is that when you do start image and end image in one of the video models, what I got, well, just from video, I think is what I use for this one. This is what you end up with. And this is how the tool transitions from one background to another. See that? It's kind of starting off with one background. They've both got to run and run and run and run, run to try and create a new background. Messy. So I used the design to get the background the same. I'll show you how. So it went from that to this. If you look at the backgrounds, the background's the same. Look, let me show you how. Go into design. I also wanted to control their gaze as well, because what they were doing is they were looking straight at the camera. And anybody who knows anything about filmmaking knows that you don't do that. It's called breaking the fourth wall. Characters don't look at the camera unless it's on purpose. Because you're the audience. What are you doing in their world? They have no interest in you. You've got nothing to do with them. She's supposed to be screaming at a dragon, right? These guys are screaming at you. I want them to look up, so they're screaming at the dragon. Okay, so into design to fix that shot. And first, the background. The first thing I did was I came over to AI Editor. I used the AI Eraser. And what I did was I just used the brush tool and I edited all around her. I'm not going to do this again and do it twice, but basically I edited around her and erased her, and we ended up with bing. Fantastic. That was important, because now I then imported the next shot, which was this one. If you actually highlight this, then go up here. I clicked on the background remove tool, and it did an amazing job, as it often does. And what I ended up with was, so this is the background, and then these guys, ta-da, they're in the foreground. What's great is because the lighting was the same and the setting was the same in both shots, they blend really, really well together, because the lighting is the dead giveaway. If your lighting is different, it's very difficult to blend it. Now, his sword's missing, so I went up to the AI editor and local edit, used the brush tool, and I kind of I did that. I'm not going to do it again, but basically I and then you click generate, and in fact I even wrote in here long sword, so you can see that there. And what I got back was indeed a long sword. Ta-da! I got several. This was the best one. Perfect. So now that I've got this image, I need to move their faces. So the next thing that I did was go over here to Face Kit. And with Face Kit, you've got Expression Edit. This is such a great tool. It asks you which layer you're working on. Because this is like Photoshop. You build layers to kind of edit your image element by element. And this is why I often use design to edit the shot to get it just the way I want it and then animate it. So you would click this one, which is the layer that has their faces on. And very helpfully, it's identified two major faces and another one over here. Not interested in this lady, but these two. So I clicked on one of those and look, watch this. You've got, so if we do the bloke, you've got all these. We're going to have him look up. So eye vertical gaze, look up, and bing. And now we go down to head angle and head pitch up. Bing! There we go, got him looking up. So I did that with both of them, and we ended up with he's looking up and she's looking up. That's my shot. That's my shot. They're looking where I want them to look, and the background is the same. So then, of course, just go up here, save as image, and there we are with the image of the girl. And not that image anymore, but now this image. And I could feed those into tools that will take a before and after reference shot and start playing around with prompts to try and get him to jump in front of her. That's a whole new problem. So far, I haven't solved that one yet. But watch. So this is how it was, the blending of him and the background and everything. He's trying to jump in front of her. Then at least the background is the same now. And here he comes running along and the background is the same. And he's here to save the day. Ta-da! So what else did I have here? Oh, and there's a long version of this. I tried to extend it to see if I could have him standing there a bit longer. Instead, they had a bit of a debate. It's like, what dragon? You call that a dragon? I don't know. It just looked big and scary to me. I couldn't be bothered to do the lip sync. But that's funny. It's not in the movie, but that would be a funny way to... All right. So... let's see. Here's a couple of others that I tried. Now, this one's using Vidu. And to be honest, none of them have great control of characters. So I'm going to have to either settle for something or I'm going to end up having to use hard cuts at the moment until the tools evolve to the point where you really can control character movement where it really looks authentic. I'm working on that. All right, but let me tell you now about the pièce de résistance for today. This is the multi-character reference. This is so good. Let me show you five images, because this is the background. Luma did a great job, actually, in helping me to create this background. It was incredibly hard to get destruction. I could get London streets at Christmas time with lights and snow, and buses and taxis, dead easy from every tool that I used. But to try to get destruction, really hard. Eventually, Luma really came through for me with a shot that really looks just what I needed it. I needed it to look like a dragon had just rampaged through Oxford Street in London. And so that's the shot. Here's the friendly dragon that I wanted in the shot. And I wanted the movie is a dark comedy. It's got an undertone of cynical playfulness, which is a weird mix, but oh, it's a great mix. It's very British. So this is the dragon that I wanted to have in this particular shot. And when you see the thing, it'll make sense. And this is a character I couldn't find when I put this together. I couldn't find the character that I was looking for. So I just grabbed him and said, he'll do just for the test. So remember this guy here. And then here's our damsel in distress. Okay, so in Katalist, the way to create a multi-reference image, it's like this. You go over here to what they have, which is a new tool, the Edit Image tool. Click on that. And down here, you've got the option to upload. So if I were to then go and upload, and you can upload several images, up to four images at the same time. And so this is what I uploaded. So I uploaded those, and then I edited, I prompted for Oxford Street, London. So I was specific about the prompt, about what I'm looking for. And it helps to reinforce it with a prompt that says Oxford Street, London, vehicles, destruction, mayhem, rubble, nighttime, Christmas. It's all these kind of things that I'm throwing in there. And then the dragon is growling at a young man who is pointing a sword at the dragon, and a princess who's hiding behind him. And what I got back was this image. And when you look at the reference image for the location, the location is remarkably similar to the reference shot. The dragon is remarkably similar to the reference image. The horns, the positioning, the coloration. Yes, it's a hand-drawn style instead of a realistic style. They're working on that. They know that it's important, and they're trying to get that resolved. If you're working on building the storyboard, start right now. Get your reference images and begin to build it. The only thing that wasn't right, of course, was that the girl was looking in the wrong direction, but he was pointing at the dragon as I'd asked. The dragon was growling at him as I'd asked. The blade was pointing at the dragon as I'd asked. She was cowering behind the guy. This may seem like nothing, but if I could show you all of the many images that I had where I tried to do that, it's painful. Anyway, I pulled it into design, did the same thing that I've just showed you how to do. Here we go. You see her face? Look at the girl's face. She's looking that way. Then I got her looking at the dragon. Looking that way. Then looking at the dragon. There is a slight loss of quality when you use this feature in design. But on balance, I'd rather have the imagery right than worry about the sharpness. Later on at the end of the project, I can start faffing with sharpness and that kind of thing if I want to. So listen, go play with design. There's a link below to design, and then go play with Katalist. It's so fun. It's working really well. I've got a link below to Katalist. Nobody's paying me to make this video, but I do have affiliate links with Dzine and Katalist. But I keep using them. This is why. That's my whole point, is I'm going to find tools that I like that work, double down on them, really get using them, and promote them. Brilliant results. Thanks for watching this far.